Today we will ask a topic about the catastrophic hemodialysis, and we will discuss together the many topics, and we selected this topic, hemodialysis catastrophe, just to show that we should take care of emergencies. I want just to declare that I learned a lot from Professor Ayman Rifai through the journey since I attached to the center in 1993 up to this moment. Every day I learn from him a lot. Professor Ayman.
Thank you very much, Hussein, for the kind introduction. Now in the next 20 minutes, I think we are going to share with you some of the nightmares that may occur during the hemodialysis sessions. Actually, these are the catastrophic and fatal complications that may occur during the hemodialysis session. In the agenda of my talk, I will discuss the different catastrophes and their causes and how they are presented, and then how they are managed, and give some examples by reported case reports. These are the five main catastrophes that could happen during the hemodialysis session. Catastrophic bleeding or hemorrhage, fatal air embolism, catastrophic hemolysis, fatal anaphylaxis, and cardiac arrest with sudden death. We have to differentiate first between catastrophes and the usual complications that we may be confronted during the dialysis session. These are the frequent complications like hypotension, cramps, nausea, headache. This is not the subject of my talk. So let's start with the first catastrophe, which is the bleeding of fatal hemorrhage. The famous or most common cause of catastrophic hemorrhage is dislodgement of the needle from the patient. So the dialysis then could be deadly and fatal. Because this subject is very important, the American Nephrology Nurse Association created a collaborative special work group which is called Venous Needle Dislodgement Special Project Group. This group reviewed venous needle dislodgement occurrence, consequences, and recommended practice and guidelines to develop strategies and resources on venous needle dislodgement to be used by the nephrology nurses and other healthcare professionals, as well as by the patients and their families. I'm going to talk about a very important issue that could help in preventing this catastrophe, which is fixation of the dialysis needle. This is the proper way how to fix the dialysis needle. The needle should be fixed in a place by a rectangular adhesive fabric plaster, and the most important that we have, that we should have this strip, this tab of adhesive used to make the chevron in position under the needle and the tubing close to the adhesive fabric with the sticky side facing upward. Then we should uplift and crossing the two ends of these to be fixed like this way. This is the proper way how to fix the needle. This is very important, and this will prevent the dislodgement and the catastrophic bleeding. So we should follow these steps. Number one, we should be aware about education for the staff and the patient and all care providing fixing the needle. The area around the vascular axis should be large enough and should be cleaned and allowed to dry before cannulation. The hemodialysis unit should follow their organization policy and procedure. And I think Professor Samir Sali in the first day advised and stressed that each dialysis unit should have its own manual that should strictly follow. Bloodlines should be loose and should be looped in this way to allow movement of the patient without pulling on the needles. And if we need repositioning of the needle, the tab should be replaced. We should not use the same tab again. And the vascular access and needles should be visible all the time during the hemodialysis. This is very important not to be covered. And the checking of the vascular access should be part of the monitoring, like the vital, when we monitor the vital sign, pulse, blood pressure, etc. We should check for each time for the vascular sign. So this picture is very, very important. We should not allow the patient to cover the needles. Another important cause of heroic or catastrophic hemorrhage is the vascular access itself, commonly this occurs the rupture of the AV fistula secondary to infection. In this situation, the hemorrhage is controlled with tourniquet emergency until the patient is transferred for further management. Another reported complication of bleeding during insertion of femoral catheter with massive bleeding due to perforation of the femoral vein, which was catastrophic, and the patient died in this situation. The next catastrophe is air embolism. Although it is rare, but it's fatal and causing chest pain and tightness with dyspnea during dialysis. It could be suspected if we found foam in the venous blood line. This will show there is suspicion that air entering the dialysis system. Or disconnection of connecting caps or blood lines can also lead to air embolism, and this is usually occurs in patients dialyzed via central venous catheters. The symptoms of air embolism depends on the patient position at the event of embolism. If in the seated patient, the air tends to migrate to the cerebral venous system without entering the heart, so the patient will be presented by loss of consciousness and convulsions. While in the recumbent position, air tends to enter the heart and then the lungs, leading to dyspnea, cough, and chest tightness. How to urgently treat such situation? Number one, clamping of the venous line and stopping the blood pump. This is very important. Number two, positioning of the patient on the left side and with the head tilting down. This is called the Durant maneuver. We should arrange for cardiorespiratory support and administration of 100% of oxygen by mask or even endotracheal tube, and sometimes we need hyperbaric oxygen therapy in cases of cerebral or neurological manifestations. And the most important aspect of air embolism is prevention, actually, as most of cases is catastrophic and are fatal. So prevention is very important by adequate function and monitoring of the devices on the dialysis machine. This is one of the most common causes, that if we need a syringe or a celiastic tube of the shunt which was cracked, this is the heparin syringe, could be cracked, and this could be a source of air to the system. This is how they look like, and all these cases or these situations can cause air embolism. And this is a fatal air embolism during dialysis. We can see that these the air bubbles in the upper foot. the air bubbles here in periphery, or could affect even the cavernous sinus, leading to fatal seizures and convulsion. And this is the common and frequent scenario that may occur during air embolism. 10 minutes after a patient began receiving hemodialysis treatment, his venous blood line separated from the catheter. And shortly after venous blood line was clamped, the patient complained of shortness of breath, the respiratory rate increased, and he was immediately placed on left side in tricuspid position and started with 10 liters per minute concoction by mask and transformed to hospital. And despite of these measures, the patient died. So, air embolism is prevented rather than treated. A third catastrophe about hemolysis. Acute hemolysis during hemodialysis is unusual, but it's also fatal. The hemolysis procedure may, due to exposure of the RBCs to either oxidation, reduction, thermal or mechanical injury, leading to acute hemolysis, and the cause may be overheating of the dialysate, using hypotonic dialysate, kinks in the blood tubes, malfunctioning of the pump of the machine, contamination by chemicals that use in sterilization, formaldehyde, peroxide, and chloramine or nitrate or copper from the water supply. So, chloramine is famous to cause hemolytic anemia in home hemodialysis and can cause fatal hemolysis in the dialysis units. Also, the kinked lines is a major cause for occurrence of hemolysis, and this hemolysis can induce fatal acute pancreatitis secondary to this hemolysis. How do we can suspect that there is hemolysis? The patient also complained of chest pain, tightness, abdominal and back pain, headache, nausea, malaise, but it should be considered if several patients complain from similar symptoms simultaneously. So I should suspect hemolysis. Venous blood became more darker and pink plasma clotted or centrifuged blood. There is drop of hemoglobin and life-threatening hyperkalemia, which is very important, can occur if unrecognized, causing fatal arrhythmia. We should stop dialysis immediately once hemolysis is suspected, and we should clamp the blood lines. We should not return the blood to avoid the hyperkalemia, and we should prepare to treat hyperkalemia and the potentially severe anemia due to hemolysis. We should investigate the cause, and the patient should be hospitalized for observations, since life-threatening hyperkalemia may develop after dialysis have been terminated. So this patient should be admitted and observed at least for 48 hours with measurements of potassium. The fourth catastrophe that may occur is fatal anaphylaxis. The anaphylaxis could be a cause of care secondary to the use of inside sterilized membranes. The complement activating cellulose membrane, the polyacrylnitrate membranes, and the use of high flux membrane, certain drugs like iron, heparin, and ACE inhibitors. Usually, the anaphylaxis and severe hypersensitivity occurs early in the dialysis session, usually in the first 10 to 30 minutes. And in case of ethylene oxide allergy, may start later or even after the end of the session. These are the manifestations of acute anaphylaxis. skin, there is pruritus, urticaria, there is swelling of the mucous membrane, there is dizziness and syncope, maybe bronchospasm and asthma, there is hypermotility of the GIT causing vomiting and diarrhea, hypotension, collapse, and shock. How we manage? We can manage in case of acute management and then identification of the offending material, which is very important. Acute management, we should stop the anesthesia without returning the blood again to the patient and cessation of eventual drug supply, if there is any. Adequate, general, and specific individualized procedure, but ephedrine should be administered to all patients with clinical signs of hypotension and shock or airway angioedema. The maximum initial dose of epinephrine is from 0.2 to 0.5 milligram in adults and in children up to 0.3 milligram. If there is no clear improvement, ephedrine, epinephrine should be repeated after 5 minutes. Antihistamine should be used in management of anaphylaxis. Corticosteroids generally be given intravenous and should be administered in any case of anaphylaxis reaction. Inhaled beta 2 agonist is useful in case of bronchospasm. Airway breathing, circulation, and level of consciousness should be assessed carefully. Then, identification of the offending material should be careful history taking of the patient. There is necessary by the treating physician, even, and thorough revision of the medical records is mandatory. Diagnostic measure for identification of the offending compound, skin tests or serology, estimating the level of IgE. And this investigation should be postponed until 4 to 5 weeks after the event, because IgE and or the basal or mast cells and mediator depletion of the possible influence of the drug that we use to treat these events. The last complication or catastrophic complication is the cardiac arrest and sudden death. There are a lot, our big list for the occurrence of cardiac arrest and sudden death in dialysis units: extreme hypotension, electrolyte disturbance, especially hyperkalemia, arrhythmia, development of angina and myocardial infarction, air embolism, or severe blood loss. If the arrest occurs immediately upon initiation of the treatment and the cause is unknown, again, blood should not be returned to the patient, and the dialyzer should be checked. An anaphylactic reaction to the dialyzer membrane or infusion of formaldehyde that was formerly used for reuse, but I think reuse is not used nowadays. All of these should be suspected as a cause of cardiorespiratory arrest during the initial period of dialysis. If the event occurs intradialytically, I mean not early after starting dialysis, and there is no reason to suspect problems with dialysate composition, patient should be returned to the blood should be returned to the patient properly and terminate the dialysis session. Sample of the dialysate should be sent for immediate electrolyte analysis along with the first patient blood sample, and the dialyzer and blood line should be saved for later analysis. This assessment is performed simultaneously with removal of the patient from dialysis chair and placement on the floor to start the cardiopulmonary stations immediately. And access line should be maintained in place to provide an access route for administration of fluids and medications. And after any cardiopulmonary arrest, the dialysis machine should be replaced. We should not use this dialysis machine until proper investigation is done and safety features have been thoroughly evaluated for possible malfunction. In this big study, they studied the instance of cardiac arrest among more than 5.5 million cases. They reported 400 cases cases of arrest over a 9-month period. Cardiac arrests were more frequent during Monday dialysis, the longest period between the Wednesday, between I mean, this is the longest period, 2.5 days maybe, between the dialysis session, rather than every other day during the last during the week. It's okay more in older and diabetic, and more likely to a patient using catheter rather than vascular access or fistula. And treatment is cardiovascular sedation and defibrillation. So what they detect from the studies, some predictors and outcome of cardiovascular sedation, that the risky patient for female or more than male, they will be risky to develop a cardiac arrest. Patient with ischemic heart disease or heart failure carries a more risk than other patients. So we should treat our dialysis unit and ICU unit. It should be fully equipped with full resuscitation machines and defibrillator. And the take home message from my talk, that resuscitation facilities, as I said, including cardiac monitoring device with defibrillator, bag valve mask, suction apparatus, functioning laryngoscope, endotracheal tube, oxygen supply, and emergency drug, of course, together with well-trained staff, should be available in the dialysis unit. And this is very important, to have a planned preventive maintenance. All machines should have a planned preventive measures and technical safety checked according to the manufacturer recommendation. Again, this is what was stated by Professor Samir in the first day, that we should have our own manual and guidelines in our dialysis units, and we should follow strictly. Monitoring of the patient during dialysis is very important. The dialysis treatment should be monitored closely, with particular attention to any intradialytic complications should be reported and managed promptly. Vital signs, blood pressure, pulse, temperature, and don't forget to look for the vascular access each time and to be registered. Of course, the vascular access monitoring during dialysis, patient should be closely monitored. If we use the fistula for the blood flow, the venous flow, the occurrence of thrombosis, infection, any skin erosions, aneurysms or pseudoaneurysms, and the catheter, we should inspect for the exit site and any signs of catheter thrombosis and any symptom and sign of catheter-related bloodstream infection. So, I think this is the most important slide, that we should have to develop what's called a culture of safety. The concept of culture of safety has to be cultivated. First, our goal is prevention. We cannot wait for one of these catastrophic events to occur. Second, safety extends to outside the dialysis facility, so we are responsible for prevent these events in our patients, not only when they are in the facility, but all the time in between the dialysis session. And lastly, my best wishes is safe dialysis for all our patients. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Ayman, for this very important presentation about how to tackle the emergencies and the catastrophes for emergencies in dialysis. And now the presentation is open for discussion. Yes.
Thank you very much for this excellent presentation. You told that this is a vital presentation. So my question is, I want to know if the other causes of dark blood line during dialysis, except on hemolysis. Thank you.
This is a mark of hemolysis, actually, to have dark bloodlines suddenly, which were bright, I mean, in the first, during the start of dialysis, they become more dark. This should raise suspicion of occurrence of hemolysis. So this is a new event. I mean, you start the dialysis session with a certain bright color, then it becomes dark. This should raise suspicion of occurrence of hemolysis. This is your question.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for your presentation. I have two questions. The first, talking about the hemorrhage on dialysis. If we have an hemorrhage, occur on dialysis about an aneurysma, how can we manage if it occur on dialysis? Actually,
first of all, you have a good. You have to perform a good tourniquet above any site of hemolysis. This is very important, and to transfer the patient immediately to the ICU and terminate the session, and to have a lot of blood available for transfusion until this could be fixed by the vascular surgeon. So everything should go hand in hand. But the tourniquet is very important and life-saving for the rupture of aneurysm.
But you should apply the tourniquet before the patient dies.
Yeah.
So it should be rapid and energetic because it's a catastrophe.
So my second question is about fatal anaphylaxis. Yes. Well, what do you think about using adrenaline on fatal anaphylaxis? What do you think about using adrenaline? Is it possible to use?
I think we should use it. I think we should use it in case of anaphylaxis, like I mentioned, in the with a dose of 0.2 to 0.5, we can ensure it repeat every 5 minutes if there is no response.
Why you are concerned by adrenaline? Why you think that adrenaline is a problem here? If we are dealing with an anaphylactic shock, whatever dialysis or not dialysis, why you are concerned? What is it? What's your concern?
To drill the anaphylactic reaction, we usually use you can use adrenaline.
So the same, because if you leave the patient may die from anaphylaxis and from ventricular fibrillation, etc. You don't know what actually will occur, because anaphylaxis means just hypotension up to death. So I don't know if there is any concern about the use of adrenaline to treat anaphylaxis in dialysis CKD. I'm not aware.
Thank you, Professor, for your presentation. It does catastrophes which are forecast for the patient in hemodialysis. But there are other kinds of catastrophes which can appear in hemodialysis as well. What could we do in case of fire, for example?
Excuse me, what? The last
other type of catastrophes which can happen in dialysis. Right. But they are talked only for catastrophes which are focused on the patient on the hemodialysis. But we can have other kind of catastrophes.
In the form of?
For example, when fire happens,
okay,
what can we do for the patient?
When fire happens, when earthquake happens, a lot of these are non-specific catastrophe for that. I think this is a disaster for the whole building, the whole city. This is another issue.
Regarding the catastrophe you mentioned, there's a good experience in the Western community how to do dialysis in the presence of earthquakes. If you have a big earthquake or volcano, everything is destroyed, how to do dialysis for these patients, because if you leave them until dialysis unit is constructed, all that, you will get rid of all dialysis patients. So they can use tent, special machine for emergency. So we should, if we have facilities, we should be equipped for the safety to face this catastrophic disasters. And if you just write on the PubMed earthquakes analysis, you will find the full text and how they created the company, this industrial company, get found to create a big tent for all dialysis patients, and rapidly all patients are dialyzed and no body died because of no dialysis. Suppose that I am inside the dialysis unit and the building is collapsing. Yes. I will die with the patients.
That is the experience. In case of fire, for example.
This is not a dialysis catastrophe. Yeah. This is a way. Even during a lecture, for example, we should. I had a machine on my patient.
This is why, Dr. Kamal, in some countries, peritoneal dialysis is the leading modality. 85%, I'm not sure it's in Norway or other country, because this is a country of earthquakes. So if there's a good come and the patient is connected to the machine, this will be a catastrophic. But if there is a castle in his abdomen, he will run with the castle. I want to stress on a point that Professor Ayman mentioned in his presentation, is simple looking at leaving the fistula as a covered. Because I witnessed a case, not here, here we witness cases, but they are saved. And this is why we adopt the policy before the guidelines. But I witnessed a case at Hôpital Sud. This was a case, 80 plus in lady, with history of past history of many fractures. What happened? The needle slipped. The venous needle slipped, so there was bleeding, and she was aged. And nurses were in the cath room. And then after this bleeding, and she didn't withstand the bleeding, and she died. She died of hemorrhage. But the consultant blamed the nurses. But at the end of the day, he wrote that the cause of death is pulmonary embolism. Based upon old age, beat down the patient, so this is a massive pulmonary embolism. And the cause of death was actually bleeding from slipped venous and unattended. So it's better to allow, as Professor Ayman mentioned, to leave the fistula uncovered.
Thank you, Professor Ayman, for your very informative talk. في نظر نظر كاتاستروف لو سنترال ووتر لو تريت الووتر لوست الكالشر ذس از نظر كاتاستروف فور اول ذا دانس يونت ماست هاف يو ماست ايفري بودي ماست ادوبت بوليسي هاو كان وي ديل وذ ذا دانس يونت اف ذا ووتر از بوست هاز بوست كالشر فور اني اورجانيزم يو هاف باك اب فور ذس ووتر تريتمنت يونت. Can you will arrange for the dialysis for those patients in another place? Because you must stop dialysis from the booster culture treatment. That one issue. And the second issue regarding the Colorex, the hemolytic anemia. If anyone use Colorex for disinfection, especially for the treated water, you must have strips to test for the residue of Colorex in the water. Yeah, and do not start dialysis for patients except after rinsing the machine several times, and then you test for the Colorex, and it must be negative for this issue. Number three, regarding regarding invisible AV fistula. Yes, in the construction of any dialysis unit, every patient must be seen by all the staff of dialysis. It is very important. And if the patient is insisting to cover the AV fistula for any reason, we must convince him it is better to be uncovered, to be seen by everybody. And the last point regarding cardiac arrest. Dr. Ayman said, you must have a crash cart including all measures for management cardiac arrest, but before this issue, every person in dialysis unit
should have
ACLS or advanced cardiac life support. How to manage patients' cardiac arrest? Because sometimes dialysis unit is totally separate from the hospitals. If inside the hospital, no problem, can put blue, and anesthesiologist can come, our cardiac, our good blue team can come. But if this is not available and there is only dialysis unit, every person dealing with dialysis unit must have ACLS or advanced cardiac life support.
Any other question?
You are satisfied? Thank you very much, Professor Ayman, for this excellent presentation. So.